Thank you for joining us. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. God is using the ministry of Lakeside to make a difference in many people's lives, and we have heard numerous stories of life change. If God has used the ministry of Lakeside to make a difference in your life, we would love to hear your story. Please email us at amen@lakesidechurch.ca.
In 1818, a roving band of actors was performing in towns throughout the Austrian Alps. On December 23rd, they arrived in Oberndorf, a village near Schlossberg, where they were to reenact the story of Christ's birth in the small church of St. Nicholas. Unfortunately, the St. Nicholas church organ wasn't working and was not to be repaired before Christmas. Because the church organ was out of commission, the actors presented their Christmas drama in a private home. That Christmas presentation of the events in the first chapters of Matthew and Luke put assistant pastor Joseph Moore in a meditative mood. Instead of walking straight to his house that night, Moore took a longer way home. The longer path took him up over a hill overlooking the village. From that hilltop, Moore looked down on the peaceful snow-covered village. Reveling in majestic silence of the wintry night, Moore gazed down at the glowing Christmas card-like scene. His thoughts about the Christmas play he had just seen made him remember a poem he had written a couple of years before. That poem was about the night when angels announced the birth of long-awaited Messiah to shepherds on a hillside. Moore decided those words might make a good carol for his congregation the following evening at their Christmas Eve service. The one problem was that he didn't have any music to which that poem could be sung. So the next day, Moore went to see the church organist, Franz Xaver Gruber. Gruber only had a few hours to come up with a melody which could be sung with the guitar. However, by that evening, Gruber had managed to compose a musical setting for the poem. It no longer mattered to Moore and Gruber that their church organ was inoperable. They now had a Christmas carol that could be sung without that organ. On Christmas Eve, the little Oberndorf congregation heard Gruber and Moore sing their new composition to the accompaniment of Gruber's guitar.
Starting a new series this morning. I love starting a new series. I love kind of selfishly being the one starting the new series because there's no one to kind of compare me to in the series. I kind of get to set the stage for it. It's very selfish, but I do secretly love it. And I am going to take a little bit of credit for this series. Bold statement to make. Pastor Dave may not quite agree with me, but I'm going to take a little bit of credit because we were actually planning the sermon series in the summer together. There was a team of us doing it. And I had said something along like, we should do famous hymns and talk about some of the meanings and the theology behind them and stuff like that. And we decided to go in a different direction, which was great. The summer series was awesome and it was great to be a part of. But then when I was coming up to the Christmas series, and they kind of said, we're doing famous Christmas lyrics. I was like, that's my idea. That was my idea before. So I'm going to secretly, not so secretly, take credit for this. And if it can be our little secret in this room, that would be fantastic. But like I said, we're looking at song lyrics of very famous Christmas songs, songs that we know, songs that we love, songs that we sing every year. And what we really want to do is kind of just unpack some of the deep truths that are really contained in what can be a very simple song at times. I think sometimes we sing these songs and we can kind of go on autopilot because they're so common to us and we sing them year over year that we don't really think about the words that are in these songs. And some of these songs just contain the most deep truths about what we believe and about the Christmas season. And we are not going to ruin any of your favorite Christmas songs and point out all of the ways that they may not line up with the Bible. But what we really want to do is celebrate the truth of Christmas that each one of them celebrates. And so, to kick off our series, I got one of the most famous Christmas songs of all time. I was given Silent Night. Very excited about that. Who here is anyone, your Silent Night is your absolute favorite Christmas song? Where's Chris Steves? He was waving his, there he is! He was literally waving his hand at the back of the first service too. I know this is his favorite Christmas song, so I have to be really careful that I don't butcher it or ruin it in any way. But this song paints a beautiful picture of this calm serenity that comes over everything. And I mean, you saw the story that this guy looked down and he saw this village, he saw this idyllic scene, and it reminded him of a poem written about the nativity story. And it's just this idea of complete tranquilness in that moment. Now, I think this song is beautiful. I have wonderful memories of singing this song at church. So often it's done by candlelight. It's done at the end of the service, often a cappella. So it's that much quieter. And I have such wonderful memories. But as I was kind of digging into the words of this song, just trying to see, you know, where I was going to take things, I'm going to admit, I was looking at the words and I'm like, do we really think it was like that on the first Christmas? You know, do we really think it was that peaceful and calm? I mean, you got a 14-year-old girl, just had a baby. I know I am terrified at that prospect. I don't imagine there's going to be much silent and calm about me. And she's got this inexperienced husband, and they, you know, they haven't been together very long, and he's going to be the one to deliver a baby. And the baby's going to be delivered in a stable and laid into a feeding trough. So there's all these animal noises around. And we know the city is buzzing because there is no room for them in the inn because the city was too full to begin with. So we know there's got to be a lot of noise from the city around here. And then all of a sudden, these shepherds are coming upon the scene, and they've just had an army of angels proclaiming to them this great news. So here's this woman, she's just given birth, and this shepherds that she's never met before are coming into her delivery room. Not the picture I'm quite imagining for myself when this moment comes, but I don't see, I see a lot of excitement. There's the sense of awe and wonder and excitement and noise. I don't know if it was really the calm, peaceful scene that we might be imagining. And that's okay. Because at the same time as I'm going through these words, as I'm praying through them and trying to kind of figure out, you know, where I want to take this morning or where God really wants me to take this morning, I was looking at some of the words that kind of finish up the verses that we sing. And in this quiet little song, there is a deep truth about who the Bible says Jesus is. I mean, really, the heart of the salvation message or the gospel is really, really contained in this very simple, quiet song. And I really want to, we don't have time to go through the whole entire thing, and I'm certainly not going to sing it for you because that would clear the room faster than anything else. But I want us to look at two lyrics in particular for this song. And it's the end of the second and the third verses. And it's these two phrases. It's Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, and Christ, the Savior, is born. And like I said, to me, these strike at the very heart of who Jesus is and why he came to this world. And this is very interesting because these are two very unique images. Actually, they're very distinct pieces or pictures of who Jesus is. And the words are very easy to say, they're very easy to read. No one who has been in church for a long time would probably disagree with them. I mean, it's kind of Christianity 101. But what I really want to do this morning is, do we know what it means that Jesus was Lord at thy birth and that Christ the Savior is born? Because this is the heart of the gospel, my friends, the good news of Jesus. This is the key reason why he came to this earth. So what I really want to do in our time together, we're actually just going to kind of pull apart what these two phrases mean, and then we're going to bring it together in the end. So I'm excited, and I hope you're excited to be here with me. And we're going to look at the first one first. It's Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. And what this phrase is saying, it's saying this truth, that Jesus is Lord. This is where you're going to pick up in your sermon notes. So it's saying Jesus is Lord. That exact phrase is said over 300 times in the New Testament alone. If we're looking at how many times Jesus is referred to as Lord, as in Lord as a placeholder for the name of Jesus, it's over 600 times. In the New Testament alone. It is the most common rendering given to Jesus, to his ministry, to his personhood. It's who he is. It is the core truth about his person. Jesus is Lord. And the Bible is clear that Jesus is not a Lord. He is not one position of authority amongst a lot of other positions of authority. He is the Lord. He is the one and only Supreme Lord. Capital L, He is Lord. For those of you who may have grown up in the church or have been followers of Christ for a while, this is a thing that you might use in your very everyday conversation. So many times we start prayers with, Dear Lord. My family, we use the phrase Lord willing a lot. It used to be, I'll see you later, Lord willing. It's kind of interesting that we do that, but it's optimistic. And it's just a phrase that we kind of use. We use the name Lord for Jesus very, very easily. But do we understand what deep authoritative meaning this word actually has? When the Hebrew Bible, which is most of the Old Testament, if you're following with me, when the Hebrew Bible was translated into Greek, at some point it was translated into Greek, the words Yahweh and Adonai, they are two words that are used to talk about God. And when they talk, those words, Yahweh and Adonai, they talk about God's supremacy. They talk about his holiness. They talk about how he is set apart amongst all others. They talk about that he is king. He is ruler. He is the ultimate authority over all. Yahweh and Adonai. When those words are translated into Greek, they are uniformly translated into the word Lord. So when we see that Jesus is Lord, when it says that in the New Testament, it is saying, this guy is God. He is the supreme authority in this earth. Many of us, I don't think we actually think this, but we think that Jesus kind of, he just kind of appears on the scene at the Christmas story. But when it says Lord at thy birth, it's saying that when Jesus was born, he was already Lord. He was already God. He was Lord at thy birth. It's not a title that he earned. It's not a title that he had to climb the social or corporate ladder to get. It wasn't a term that was given or a name that was given to him in that moment and only for his time while he was on this earth. He was already Lord. Jesus is God, and he was Lord when he was born on this earth. He was Lord at his birth. As Christians, we believe that Jesus is God the Son. We often hear this phrase, Son of God. It can also be translated as God the Son. We believe in one God who exists in three distinct parts, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All three parts of God are eternal. They have always existed, and they always will exist. Jesus was there in creation. He was there throughout the entirety of the New Testament. He came to earth in a visible form for us. But he was Lord when he did that, and he existed long after he left this earth. He still exists. He is the living God. Jesus is eternal. John 1, very famously, it's in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And we learn very quickly about three verses later that the Word is Jesus. Jesus is eternal. I love what Colossians 1, 15 to 19, this is how it describes Jesus. It says, the Son, so Jesus, he is the image of the invisible God. He is God in flesh. He is the God that we saw. He is the firstborn over all creation. He was there before creation. For in him, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, saying he is supreme to all of these things because they were created by him. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. Do you notice how many times it says the word all and everything? He is before all things. He is ruler over all things. In everything, he has supremacy. There is no one higher than Jesus. Jesus is the fullness of God. Everything is under his authority. He is the ruler, the eternal ruler. The whole earth came into being through him, and he was there to make it happen. He is the ruler over all things. I mean, just look at the life of Jesus while he was here on this earth. Look at how he lived his life. it was with a distinct authority. He didn't live like other prophets and other teachers. Some people try to say that Jesus was just another prophet or just another teacher. He didn't live his life that way. That's not what we see. This is a man, God in human flesh, who when the storms were erupting, he put out his hands and he said, stop. And the waves and the storm, they listened to him. He had control over nature. He walked on water and it held its weight. He told demons when their end date was going to be. He had authority over the body, not his, but well, his and his. But he had authority over other people's bodies. He healed people. He took away their sickness and their disease. I mean, one of my favorite stories of Jesus is he had authority over death. There's a story in the Bible where his friend Lazarus died. He's been dead for days. And he goes and stands in front of Lazarus' tomb and says, hey, Lazarus, you're not going to be dead anymore. That's kind of awesome. He told Lazarus, who was dead, that he wasn't going to be dead anymore. And Lazarus walked out of a tomb. He had such authority. In Philippians 2, talking about his authority and the authority of Jesus, it says this. It says, therefore God exalted him to the highest place. He is at the highest place. And he gave him the name that is above every name. That at the very name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. It says that Jesus is supreme. Everything in heaven, everything on earth, he rules it. He is preeminent. I love that line, that at the very name of Jesus, just the pronouncement of his name, every knee will bow before him and recognize his authority. Everything on heaven and earth will one day submit to him. And this image of Silent Night is so beautiful because it tells of a baby. It's the ultimate form of human weakness. A baby is one of the weakest forms that we have, and yet even in that form of weakness, he is still Jesus. He is still Lord. He is still ruler. And this, the dichotomy of that image, I think, is just the most beautiful thing. That here in this baby is the image of power and authority and wisdom. This eternal being in human flesh. And yet coupled with this image, so we have Jesus, Lord at thy birth. We have this other image of Jesus that's in the song Silent Night. It says, Christ the Savior is born. And Jesus is Savior. Jesus is Lord, but Jesus is also the Savior. In the book of Matthew, in chapter 16, there's this really cool exchange between Peter, one of the disciples, and Jesus, and we believe that the other disciples are around to see this happen. And Jesus looks at Peter, and he says, Peter, who does the world say that I am? I want you to tell me what the word on the street is. You know, who do people think that I am, who have seen me, and you know, what's the word? And Peter says lots of things. He says, well, some people think you are John the Baptist resurrected. Other people think you're Elijah, maybe one of the other prophets. He gives them a list of some of what people are saying about Jesus. And then Jesus looks at him. He says, Peter, who do you say that I am? You, Peter, you know me. You travel with me. You walk with me. I disciple you. You know me so well. You see me in my unguarded and my guarded moments. Who do you, Peter, say that I am? And Peter says this. He says, you are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God. He says, you are the Christ. So often we hear the name Jesus Christ, and we think that Christ is Jesus' last name, which it's not. Christ is an image. It's a title. It's a position. It's the idea of the Messiah, the long-awaited Messiah that God's chosen people had waited for. They wanted to be saved, and the image of the one that was going to save them was called the Messiah, the Christos, the anointed one. It speaks still of an image of an anointed ruler, the idea of the Christos, the Messiah, the Christ. He would still be an anointed ruler, a chosen one. But in his kingship, this kingly figure, rather than, you know, reign and rule and be a tyrant and be cruel, it shows that in his authority, in his rule, that he rescues, that he saves, that he loves. He is a tender king. There's no tyranny. There's no hardship. It's the idea of a king and a ruler who is compassionate, who is merciful, who uses his authority to save a people that he loves. It is an image of someone who just extends grace to his people. I one time had a friend who asked me, didn't really know a lot about faith or a lot about what I believed, and they asked me, they said, "So can you sum up the Bible for me in 1 minute?" That is a challenge. One that I did try to take on, and I probably did not do it very eloquently, but I'm going to try to do it here this morning because I think it really speaks into this image of Jesus as Savior. And this is somewhat what I said. I think I stuttered and a lot more than I hopefully will today. But the story of the Bible is a story of a God who created the world, and he loved the world, and he loved his creation in it. But these first humans that he created, humans that he loved, humans that had a beautiful relationship with him, humans that got to literally walk with him, they disobeyed him. They forgot that God was their Lord, their master and their creator and their ruler. And they cheapened the freedom that God gave them. And they disobeyed him. They did the one thing they weren't supposed to do. And this caused a separation between God and the creation that he so loved. And God hated this separation. He hated that this had to happen. But there was sin and disobedience in the world. But God promised that there would be a way, that there would be redemption one day, that he was going to find a way to bring all people back to him. And then the law was given to his chosen people. And this law was perfect and holy and beautiful, but the people couldn't keep it. They couldn't uphold it. They couldn't do it. They couldn't make themselves righteous. They couldn't bridge the gap between themselves and God. They couldn't do it. And so because of that, this law became a burden to them rather than a blessing. So God kept on foreshadowing and promising a time when his redemptive plan would happen, when he would one day reconcile people to him. And he promised that it would come through an individual, that someone with authority was going to come and was going to make this redemption happen, was going to bring the people back to God. And the curse of sin and death, this eternal separation, the punishment for sin would be broken. That sin and death would be conquered by God himself, God in flesh. And he would bear sin and death. He would become sin so that we would not have to pay the penalty for sin anymore. Sin and death were defeated. That's what it means with the resurrection. It means that death is no longer final. Death is defeated. We do not have to be separated eternally from God. God promised one that would be the Savior, that would bring this to fruition. And that is what Jesus is, the fullness of God in human form who conquers sin and death. And yes, we still struggle with those things. We are still going to die, and we still struggle with sin, but ultimately it is conquered. Jesus is the Savior. We read a passage from Colossians earlier. I'm actually going to go a little higher up in it because this is the image of Christ as the Savior. It says, "For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves." So he's saying, God has rescued us from darkness. And he talks about the Son. It says, "In the Son, whom we have redemption," we have the forgiveness of sins. Because of Jesus, we have this redemption. It says, "Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior." Once you were separated from God because of your sin, but now he has reconciled you. You have returned him by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. The sin in your life is placed upon Jesus. It was placed upon his body, and it died with him. You can be free from the curse of sin and death. I love John 3:17. We talk about John 3:16 in church all the time. It's a great verse too, but I love John 3:17, which follows it. And it says that Jesus came into the world not to condemn the world. He didn't come to show this world just how awful it was and to be just this horrible judge that made us feel miserable about ourselves and show us how hopeless it was for us. He didn't do that. He came to the world so that the world could be saved through him. He used all his authority to save a people that he loved. He came, he was born, so that we would be reconciled to God, forgiven of our sins, free from the curse of sin, no longer enslaved to the ways of this world. And that, my friends, is good news. That is the gospel. It is good news that our sins can be forgiven, that the slate can be wiped clean, that death is defeated, and that we can spend eternity with the living God who loves us that much. I love in Romans 8, it says that nothing can separate you from the love of God through Christ Jesus, our Lord. It's a beautiful fusion of what we've been talking about. Jesus is the Savior, and we celebrate his birth because of what his life and death and resurrection means for us who follow after him. There's a very old Christian creed, and what I mean by creed is basically just a statement of faith. And it's called the Apostles' Creed. And it was a creed that really brought together the early church. The early church was having some disagreements about things that they believed. And what this creed is all about, it's bringing together key truths about the Christian faith, that everyone could say, yes, we all believe in that. It's not in the Bible, but it is very biblical in nature. It takes truths of the Bible and puts it into one statement. And the second line of this statement, it starts off with, I believe, and then it says in the second statement, it says, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. It pulls together everything that we've been talking about in a beautiful way. It recognizes Jesus as the Christ, the Christos, the anointed one, the Messiah, the one who has come to save us from our sin. It recognizes that he is God in flesh, that Jesus was fully God and fully human at the exact same time, and that because he was fully God, he is our Lord. It is a proclamation of faith that Jesus is our ruler. It recognizes the truth that's there in Silent Night, that Jesus is Lord at thy birth, and that Christ, the Savior, was born. It's that we can be saved from our sins. We can be brought back into a relationship with God, and that God can be the ruler of our lives. But what the Apostles' Creed and Silent Night, and really what the Bible make very, very clear, is that you cannot pick which one Jesus is. You can't do it. He can't be just a ruler and not a savior, and he can't be just a savior and not a ruler. The two are completely linked together. But here's the problem that I see, and I see it in my own life all the time, and I see it in ministry, and I see it in the church, the worldwide church, I just see it, is that so often we want to choose one or the other. We don't really want Jesus to be both. There are some of you here who would fully go, yes, Christ is the Savior, I totally get that, I am 100% on board, he is the Savior. But no part of you, no part of anything inside of you wants to call him Lord, wants to submit to his authority. You might say you do, I say I do all the time, but I know that so often my life doesn't reflect that. I love the idea of Jesus as Savior, but I struggle with the idea of Jesus being Lord, because Jesus being Lord means that he is the ruler of my life, that he is my ultimate authority. It means that everything, In all things, he might have supremacy. If I believe that, that means that everything in my life has to come under his authority. My resources, my money, my time, my job, my family, all of those things have to come under his authority if I say that Jesus is Lord. And that is really, really hard, because it means that I have to give up the control of everything and I have to turn it over to, in obedience to him. Please know, none of us are ever going to get this perfect. That's not what I'm trying to say here, especially people who are really new to faith or just trying to explore things. This takes some time to be worked out in our lives. It's not something that just naturally happens or comes really easily. It's not like that. It's not an immediate thing. It tends to happen as we grow closer to Jesus, as we mature in our faith. It's not about being perfect. That's not what I'm trying to say here. I can't live up to that standard, and it would be 100% unbiblical of me to try to teach that standard. But I do have to say this. There are some of us here, and I 100% include myself in this, and we have been Christians for a while, and we should be maturing in our faith, and we should be growing closer towards Christ. But there is this very strange sense inside many of us in which we feel like I just can't submit to the rulership of Christ. Christ can be my Savior, but I just can't submit to his rule. And I am here to tell you that if that's you, if you're there with me, that is a foreign concept in the Bible. It doesn't exist. You can't say that. The Bible does not give us that option. We don't get to say we are followers of Christ. We don't get to just say with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and not at least try to live it out. If that is your view of Jesus, that Jesus is just a Savior, and a Savior is an amazing thing in and of itself, but if he is just the Savior, then Jesus is really just your insurance policy or something to make you feel better about yourself. You want him to remove the bad. You want him to bathe you with compassion, but you don't want to acknowledge the wisdom or the authority that he has. You want forgiveness, and you want all the bad stuff to be put aside. You want freedom from all of the bad stuff, but you want to do that while still living your life the exact way you want to, without ever coming under the rulership of Christ. And if that is how we live, then we are ignoring a key truth in the Bible, and that is that Jesus knows the absolute best way for us to live our lives, and that he commands us, not just desires. Jesus commands that we live that way. Jesus made it very clear, if you want to be my follower, you have to actually follow me. You have to do that. If you want to say that you are my follower, you have to actually follow me. And again, none of us are going to get this perfect, and I don't want to pretend that I am more perfect than someone else, because I'm not in any way, but there has to be at least a desire for that, or a desire to desire that, to want that in our lives, to come under the rulership of Christ. And please know, if I can leave one point with this, it's that this does not have to be a scary thing. The rulership of Jesus is one of the most beautiful things you will ever experience in your life. So many times we hear this word submit in our culture, and it's used so incorrectly, and we think it means that we just have to be just so weak. Well, one, I hate to break it to you, but next to God, you really are weak. There is nothing you can do to save yourselves. You are weak next to him. But this idea of living under his rulership, it means that you live a life of meaning and purpose. It means that God wants to use you in amazing ways. It means that you get to be transformed to become more like the image of Jesus. He wants to do a transformative work in you. It shows you a different way to live. Jesus said, I came to give you life, and I'm coming to give you life to the full. He wants to give you life to the full. It isn't always easy, but it is always the best way to live. It is a beautiful rulership that he could have over our lives if we simply give him control. Others of you, you might be sitting here and you have no problem obeying Jesus. You have no problem saying Jesus is Lord of your life, and you have no problem with rules and deeds and with actions, but here's the problem, is that you think that that is somehow going to save you. That acting right is going to erase your sin, rather than acknowledging your need for the grace and compassion of Jesus the Savior. Others of you, you might fear, you know, wrath, or you fear that God will punish you in some way if all of your deeds don't completely line up. Maybe some of you are here and you don't believe that God is a merciful God. You believe that God is a tyrant. And you struggle to see that God is a God of mercy. You struggle to see that God wants to reach out to you in compassion. You feel that God could never forgive you for what you have done, and you wallow in guilt and shame and will try to do anything to erase it from your lives. But you are going to do it yourself. You are determined to make up, that somehow you are going to make yourself good enough. My friends, if that is our goal, we have missed the point of grace. Grace says that nothing you do will ever make God love you more or less, and that you cannot earn his saving. You can't earn it. He is the Savior. You can't earn that. It is simply grace. We need to see Jesus as a person, well, not as a person, as a God who uses his authority and his reign to rescue and to save, and who wants to forgive you and free you from the curse of sin and death. We have a Jesus who hung on a cross and said to each and every one of us that you are worth dying for. You cannot save yourself, but you are worth this price. Friends, the Bible does not give us a choice about which Jesus works better in our life. We don't get to choose which version of Jesus is best for us. He is both ruler and Savior. And let me tell you this, we need him to be both. Every single one of us needs him to be both. I love Romans 10, 9 to 13. It brings this idea together just in such an amazing way. It says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, if you say that, if you make that statement of faith, and if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, if you believe that God can free you from the curse of sin and death, you will be saved. It is a promise. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. It's a dual piece here. There's a piece of believing in our heart, of our heart being turned towards God, but there's also a piece of living that out. It says, if you profess with your mouth, it's about living that out. As Scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew or Gentile. The same Lord, Jesus is Lord. He is Lord of all. And he richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, everyone who recognizes Jesus as Lord will experience Jesus as Savior as well. If we say Jesus is Lord, our lives have to reflect that confidence. Is there anything in your life that you are attempting to hide from Christ? Have you refused to do something you know Jesus is calling you to do? Are you inviting Jesus into the darkest areas of your life and allowing him to transform you into his image? Are you recognizing that nothing, nothing you do, no amount of doing the right things will ever, ever be enough? You need a Savior. You need a Lord. He must be Lord and Savior. He is inherently both. We cannot pick which one he is. I want to model this a little bit with a story that comes from the Bible. And it comes from John 8, 1 to 11. And it's not part of the Christmas story, but it's a story that every time I read it, without fail, I find something new that I love about this story. It's absolutely just one of my favorites. And it's a story of a woman, and she gets caught cheating on her husband, and we do not know her background, we do not know the state of her marriage, we don't know her past, we don't know her history, we don't really know anything about her husband whatsoever. All we know is that she has been caught cheating on her husband, and she is brought to the feet of Jesus, and she knows exactly why she is there. The crowd around her who are condemning her, who are calling her a sinner, they're not letting her forget. She knows why she is at the feet of Jesus. She has broken the holy Jewish law. And adultery was punishable by death. And there is a crowd of people around her, likely mostly men. They tended to carry out the judicial things back then. And these men have picked up these stones on the ground, these large, large stones. And they want to throw them at her, and they want to kill her because she has broken a sacred law. And it does say that the punishment for breaking this is death. They don't care if she's sorry. They don't care if she wants to change. All we know is that they want her to pay the price for what she has done. And they want Jesus to pronounce the judgment over her. They want to catch Jesus. They want to force Jesus into a situation where he has to pronounce judgment over this woman. And Jesus says a very famous line that many of us remember. It says, "Let he who is without sin cast the first stone." Jesus is pointing out, none of you are perfect. Who are you to judge this woman for her failings in this way? And of course, because all of these men have to admit that, yes, we are not perfect, they drop the stones and they walk away. And so often we kind of just leave the story at that point. But I want us to actually focus on what happens after. So everyone is leaving. There's this woman, she's on the ground. And Jesus kneels down to her, and he looks at her, and I believe with all my heart that he sees this woman for everything she is, for everything she isn't, for all of her vulnerability. He sees this woman. And he says to her, he says, "I am not going to condemn you." The law would have condemned her. The people who were around her who wanted to stone her, they wanted to condemn her. Jesus says, "I am not going to condemn you." And then he says this line to her. He says, "Your sins are forgiven. Now go and sin no more." He shows her amazing grace in this moment. She knew what the punishment for adultery would be, and yet here she is, vulnerable and exposed, and she is forgiven by the Savior. It is a beautiful moment. He takes away her sins, but after he talks about her sins being forgiven, he gives her a tender command. He says, "Now go and sin no more." He is saying, now it's time to live your life under the authority of God, to submit to God in the way he would have you live your life. Turn away from the way that you were living. He loves her. He saves her. He doesn't justify what she's done. She has absolutely done something wrong in this situation, and he does not tell her that it's all right. But then he looks at her and with tenderness says, "Guess what? It's time for you to change." He says that in light of this forgiveness, you need to live your life differently. Friends, if we are going to call ourselves followers of Christ, in light of the forgiveness that we have been extended by the Savior, we need to live our lives differently. We need to confess that Jesus is Lord, accept the forgiveness of our sins, and let ourselves begin the transformation process of looking just a little bit more like Jesus. There's another line in Silent Night. It's actually the end of the first verse, and it says, "Sleep in heavenly peace." And like I said earlier, I'm not so sure what this night actually looked like. I don't know what all the characters in the Nativity were really thinking or what they were feeling or whether or not it was the peaceful scene that is created. But I do know that there's a word in the Bible that is used for peace. It's one of the most common words used for peace, and it is the word shalom. And shalom talks about a very heavenly peace. It talks about a peace that doesn't mean tranquility or calmness or even the absence of conflict. Shalom means wholeness. It means restoration. It means completeness. It means that it is well. That is a heavenly peace. That is a shalom. And I believe with all of my heart, and I'm pretty sure it's taught in the Bible, but if we live a life where Jesus is Lord, where we confess that Jesus is Lord and live under his authority, and where we are saved by his amazing grace, that there is a peace that can be ours, a heavenly peace that we can rest in, a shalom, a wholeness, a reconciliation, a restoration, that we can rest in a heavenly peace. And with that peace, we can say, it is well. If you'll bow your heads in prayer with me. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the words that you have inspired in people so long ago, words that speak of your rulership, of you being Lord over this earth, God, of your authority. God, we pray that we may have the courage and the strength. It can be so hard to do it, but may we have the courage and the strength to not only just say with our lips that you are Lord God, but truly live it out, to give over every part of our life to you, knowing that in everything you have supremacy, God. We thank you for that. We are so incapable of being supreme, God, but you are supreme over all things. And God, we thank you for the truth that Jesus is our Savior, that you had a plan to restore and to reconcile people to you, a plan of love and of grace, and a plan that would save us from a separation, a plan that would save us from sin, from the ways of this world. God, we thank you that you are continuing to work out this plan in our lives, God, and we thank you for Jesus the Savior. We could not save ourselves. We are not capable of saving ourselves. Nothing we do will ever be enough, and yet you made a way for us, God. You are enough when we can't be enough, God, and we thank you for that. We praise you for that, and I pray for shalom. I pray for this heavenly, heavenly peace to dwell in our hearts, to dwell in our families, in our homes, in our country, and in this world, God. I pray for shalom, for restoration and reconciliation, and for wholeness to be brought into this earth, God, that we may see that things are well. And we lift up this prayer for shalom to you, God. And we pray in your Son's name, the name of Jesus, who is Lord, and Jesus, who is our Savior. Amen.
Well, as we close our service this morning, I would like to invite you to please stand with us one more time. We're going to sing Silent Night. And our prayer for you this morning is that, as Lindsay's spoken to us, that this song has maybe a bit more of special meaning to you this morning.
Oh,
Thanks so much for listening. We hope you enjoyed this message. To hear it again or other messages, please visit us at lakesidechurch.ca.